Good afternoon to everybody, and it's a great honor and pleasure to give this lecture about the role of complement in hemolytic anemias. My name is Vilma Barcellini. I work in Milan in the University Hospital in Italy, and the complement system, I started with a very complex slide, just reminding that the complement comprises a large number of plasma proteins that are activated by a proteolytic cleavage, a cascade, and the main topic is that the complement is directed to fight infections via activation of several inflammatory responses, opsonization and lysis of pathogens. There are three main pathways of complement: the classic pathway, which is generally triggered by antibody binding, the mannose binding lectin, and the alternative pathways, which is an amplification loop for the other two pathways. And there are also many regulatory mechanisms to prevent uncontrolled complement activation. Many factor A, factor H, and most importantly for our topic, the CD55 or DAF, decay accelerating factor, that inhibits the formation of new C3 and C5 convertase, and the CD59 or MIRL that inhibits directly the membrane attack complex. The slide, at the right of the slide, there is a very complex net, but is to underline that there is a close integration and interaction between the complement cascade, which is in gray, and the coagulation cascade in green. Fortunately, we will be able to simplify the story. And this is the simplified complement system. The three main, the classic, the lectin, and the alternative pathway, all the cascade of these proteins, C3, C2, C4, C3, C5, and then the complex, the final complex, C5, C9, or MAC. And the two main mechanisms that are extravascular hemolysis, which mainly gives the phagocytosis of C3 opsonized red blood cells, mainly in the liver and partially in the spleen, and the intravascular hemolysis, where the red blood cell destruction occurs directly in the bloodstream. And there are particular signs that everybody knows about extravascular hemolysis. This is mainly chronic, sometimes is acute, and the markers are unconjugated IgA-bilirubin, reticulocytosis, consumption of haptoglobin, and clinically Golson, splenomegaly, and iron overload with the frequency that is maximal at the top and lower at the bottom of this list. And the amount of destruction is about 17 ml per hour, is 420 ml in 24 hours. Quite different the situation with intravascular hemolysis, where the destruction is 200 ml in 1 hour. So the clinical consequences are quite different. In addition, intravascular hemolysis is acute, sometimes chronic, but frequently acute. And the markers of hemolysis going from top to bottom are increased LDH, differently from extravascular, increased the plasma free hemoglobin, hemoglobinuria, hemosiderinuria, and then all the other signs that we have already mentioned. The second very complicated slide that I want just to show is that hemolytic disease are a lot of diseases. They comprise congenital causes, the red membrane disorders, the enzymopathies, and other very rare conditions. And the warning is that if the diagnostic flowcharts turns negative for congenital hemolytic forms, you have to reconsider the acquired causes and vice versa. The message is keep the mind open. And now, in my lecture, I will speak about the complement involvement in these three conditions that are immunomolytic anemias, PNH, and hemolytic uremic syndrome. The topics so will be warm and cold forms, PNH use, immunomolytic anemia. The most important distinction is between warm and cold forms. Warm forms, the great majority are due to IgG that possibly fix complement, usually react at body temperatures. Given that the direct antiglobulin test or Coombs test positive for IgG or weakly for complement, and particularly in vivo resulting extravascular hemolysis in the spleen. The cold forms, 20-25% are due to IgM, will fix very well complement, react in the cold, the DAT is positive for complement, and hemolysis is intravascular and, as shown before, extravascular in the liver. Then we have a very rare condition, which is paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria, which is due to the Donnan-Langsteiner biphasic hemolysin, and this is a really very rare condition. And then we have the mixed forms where cold and warm antibodies coexist. Importantly, the complement system in warm and cold is differently involved. In IgG, that are monomers and weakly activate complement and do not spontaneously agglutinate, the mechanism of destruction is extravascular hemolysis in the spleen and is mediated via the Fc receptor, via the so-called antibody-dependent cellular cytotoxicity. Whilst in the cold forms, the IgM that fits very well complement may activate the classic and also the other pathways, but mainly the classic, and the hemolysis is extravascular in the liver. Sometimes, if the activation is very huge, we reach the complete activation of the complement cascade, and we reach the intravascular hemolysis and erythrocyte destruction in the bloodstream. Another important thing to remind is that the direct antiglobulin test, the cornerstone of diagnosis, is not always positive. We have 10% of autoimmune hemolytic anemia that are that negative, and we have several possible solutions that mainly are involve the use of more sensitive techniques. And it's important also to remind that also positivity is not specific for the diagnosis, as it is possible to have a positive DAT in healthy population, in a patient treated with immunoglobulins, in the presence of hypergamma or paraproteins, therapy with daratumumab, and also in recent transfused patients for the presence of low antibodies. Autoimmune hemolytic anemia is a clinically heterogeneous disease with potentially life-threatening complications. You see a lot of pneumonia, sepsis, acute renal failure, the association with with thrombocytopenia, which the name is Evans syndrome, and this gives a really hard risk for death related to autoimmune hemolysis. But I would particularly underline the thrombotic complications, the stroke, ischemia, pulmonary embolism, and which are present in 11-20% of cases are associated with severe forms, intravascular hemolysis, and previous splenectomy. And it's also important to remind that the disease may be primary or secondary. 50% of cases there is no underlying disease. In the other cases, you can have other autoimmune diseases, lymphoproliferative disorders, infections, drugs, solid tumors, allogenic or autologous stem transplant. What happens when we look at warm autoimmune hemolytic anemia where there is complement involvement? Here is our great number of patients, and if you look at patients with worm that have a complement involvement, these cases are more severe and hemoglobin is lower, LDH is greater, and the reticulocytosis may be inadequate, and there is also a high risk of relapse, so the need of additional therapies beyond the first line, which is of course steroids. This is the classic algorithm of warm autoimmune hemolytic anemia, where steroids represent the first line, and I would underline that in acute cases and very severe, the therapy with steroids should be generously given with bolus and also plasma exchange, and an early use of a second line rituximab is also advised. It is also important to consider the risk of infections, but also the thrombotic events. What happens after steroid therapy is effective in roughly 50% of cases, maybe something more, but the sustained response is present only in 30% of cases. So second line, the choice between splenectomy and rituximab. Rituximab has a very good response, 78% of cases, less effective when you have complement involvement. And the cons are, of course, infusion reaction, neutropenia, hypogamma globulinemia, reactivation of underlying infections, and now in the COVID era, also a lower response to vaccination and also to infection, of course. Splenectomy is still a good option with responses in about 80%, but the cons are serious infections and again thrombotic events. We have also several surgical complications, and particularly for patients with cardiopulmonary disorders, thrombotic risk, immunodeficiency, lymphoproliferative disorders, autoimmune conditions, or age greater than 65, 70 years, is this clearly discouraged. Immunosuppressors are generally administered as the steroid-sparing agents and now are moving to third line because responses are mainly partial and generally due to the contemporary administration of steroids. There are new drugs and ongoing studies in warm autoimmune hemolytic anemia, and as I mentioned, complement, we have ongoing studies with anti-C1Q inhibitors, with anti-C3, we still don't have the results. When we have other, and since the mechanism involved in the pathogenesis of the disease are many, we have other possible therapeutic strategies. One of the most interesting are the anti-neonatal Fc receptor. I put here a cartoon. This neonatal Fc receptor was first described about 50 years ago and is responsible for the salvage of Ig from catabolism. So blocking this receptor increases IgG clearance, and the clearance of IgG includes pathogenic autoantibodies. This, of course, results also in reduced IgG. And then we have also fosamatinib, which is a spleen tyrosine kinase inhibitor, and other inhibitors like BTK, PI3K, and also other monoclonal antibodies targeting plasma cells or association of drugs. So it's a very interesting field and a lot of drugs developed. The other is called agglutinin disease. We have the opportunity to review with my friend and colleague Sigyn Bernstein, which lives in Norway, which is a very cold country, 232 patients also involving other countries in North Europe. And we had an interesting finding is that we found a fourfold difference prevalence in cold and warm climates, and it is clearly clear to understand. If the autoantibody, which is an IgM, has a thermal amplitude close to body temperatures, this results in binding in vivo. And so we will have a classic complement-mediated hemolytic anemia, and sometimes also agglutination-mediated ischemic symptoms in the arterial circulation. This is the picture of the distribution. We have about one third of cases very severe. In the middle, patients with hemoglobin levels around 10. And then also some cases, few cases that have good hemoglobin levels. So maybe these patients will not need no therapy. Also other markers, bilirubin, LDH, haptoglobulin show a very wide distribution, and also the titer of the cold agglutinin disease is quite different from the various patients. The mean age is 67 years, so it's a middle advanced age. 60% are diagnosed within that year, 1 year, but we have also some problems in diagnosing some patients. And in one, we had 32 years to have the diagnosis. Generally, there are exacerbations of hemolytic anemia during febrile disease, and this is because complement is activated during infections. About 45% require transfusions, and again, just to remind them our very complicated picture, 30% experienced a thrombotic events, with some patients having more than one event. And the events were also severe, and pulmonary embolism, stroke, myocardial infarction, and so on. Therapy, steroids are poorly effective, are effective only in high, at high doses, so you can use them in the first days when the diagnosis is not clear. Splenectomy is completely ineffective as the destruction is complement mediated in the liver mainly or intravascular. The classic immunosuppressant have some effect. So therapy is based on in secondary forms, of course, in treat underlying disease, in a symptomatic and non-severe form in a wait and watch strategy. And when you have a symptomatic severe hemolysis requiring transfusion and with the circulatory symptoms in the acute setting, plasma exchange, early use of rituximab, steroid boluses, because you don't know how exactly to do. There are some reports on the efficacy of eculizumab, but mainly you have to go to complement inhibitors. In chronic forms, rituximab is effective, but not so effective as in war forms. The association with bendamustine or fludarabine increases efficacy, but worsens the side effects. And so clinical trials are clearly encouraged. And the very nice results that have been published, recently published with complement inhibition, show that this is a main mechanism in this disease. Sutimlimab is a humanized monoclonal antibody directed against C1s, and the administration of the drug clearly improves very quickly hemoglobin, lowers bilirubin and others markers of hemolysis, and completely inhibits the classic complement pathway. Now we move to PNH, a quick refresh of the pathogenesis. The disease is due to the failure of stem cells to express GPI anchor proteins because of somatic mutation in the PGA gene. Among these GPI proteins, this anchor that binds these proteins to the membrane, there are the CD55 and 59, which are negative regulators of complement activation. I told it at the very beginning, CD55 here on C3 and 59 here at the end of the cascade. And there are a lot of other GPI anchor proteins, but of course I don't go into all these details. The diagnosis was in the past with the sucrose lysis test and HAM test, now abandoned. Now flow cytometry with the GPI that detects GPI anchor proteins using monoclonal antibodies is the test of choice. It is important to test granulocytes and at least one additional cell types, better monocyte and red cells, keeping in mind that the percentage in red cells may be affected by hemolysis or blood transfusions, and this results in a lower percentage of GPI negative clone in red cells. Clinically, the synthesis of the disease is that this is the great impersonator because it has so many symptoms that sometimes look very specific: fatigue, asthenia, dyspnea, abdominal pain, chest pain, headache, male impotence, mild cytopenias. And so the physician can underestimate the disease, but under the very nice and calm sea, there are thrombosis, bone marrow failure, renal failure, possible clonal evolution, and these are really very harmful PNH complications. Not only I underline the heterogeneity of the disease, but the disease can also change over time. So it can start with the symptoms of the intravascular hemolysis and the thrombosis, and can evolve in bone marrow failure or vice versa. Mainly, the clinical manifestations are determined by the size of the clone, the PNH clone. But again, here there is a great heterogeneity. You can see from the International PNH Registry that the disease can present at different ages, so the diagnosis should be considered with congenital forms. We can have very low levels of LDH or very high, and we can also have quite normal values of hemoglobin. We can have severe thrombocytopenia or neutropenia. Again, the differential diagnosis is complicated. And also the granulocyte clone, as I told you before, it can be very variable. So the IPIG, the International PNH Interest Group, has tried to classify the disease, and there is the classic form dominated by intravascular hemolysis. The bone marrow is a rich bone marrow, and the clone is generally greater than 50%. Then we have PNH in the setting on other bone marrow failure syndromes. Generally, the intravascular hemolysis is mild. We have evidence of this bone marrow condition, which is generally NMDS or aplastic anemia. And the clone is quite variable, but generally is below 50%. And then we have the subclinical with no evidence of intravascular hemolysis, no evidence of concomitant bone marrow failure syndrome or NDS, and a small PNH clone. The most important clinical sign of the disease is thrombosis. And about 50% of patients with PNH experience thrombosis associated with large clones. On the right, you see very well how the curves of the risk of thrombosis indicate that when the clone is greater than 50%, the risk is absolutely increased compared with smaller clones. However, thrombosis may occur also in patients with low levels of hemolysis, no transfusion required, smaller clones. So it's always a harmful complication to always to consider. It can be the presenting symptom, and the first event may be fatal and accounts for 50% of all known deaths. Anticoagulation therapy may be inadequate to control thrombosis. And when the disease is associated with thrombocytopenia, anticoagulation may also put the patient at high risk of hemorrhages. And there are a lot of undiagnosis thrombosis. We have made some studies, we and also our colleagues in Germany, and one was to evaluate patients neurologically asymptomatic by brain MRI. And we found an increased frequency of ischemic findings, more severe lesions, and the presence of vascular abnormalities suspected for a prior asymptomatic venous thrombosis in PNH cases. Of course, compared with the agent sex match controls, as vascular complications are age related. And the German colleagues evaluated also the rest of the body with a whole body MRI, and they were able to detect silent bone and renal infarction. So it's really an important question, thrombosis in PNH. And also evaluating other known risk factor for venous thrombosis, that is 5-Leiden, deficiency of antithrombin or protein C, protein S, or other well-known thrombotic condition, the relative risk for a first venous thrombotic event is clearly increased in PNH 59 as compared to the other well-known condition, prothrombotic condition. In addition, if there are other factors that put the patient at risk for thrombosis, of course, age, malignancy, some lupus anticoagulant or autoimmune and inflammatory conditions, overweight, obesity, surgery, immobilization, pregnancy, and hormone therapy. So when you put several conditions, the risk is can clearly be increased. And again, given the close integration between complement and coagulation cascade, we have to keep in mind these very important complications in PNH patients. Now, I will show you some of our very nice data that we performed when Bruno Fattizio, one of my main collaborators, was at London King's College. He was able to study 3,085 patients that came to the lab with cytopenia testing from PNH. And going from clone greater than 50% to 1050, 110, 0.11, and less than 0.1, we can see that the larger the clone, the greater the prevalence of PNH. Going to a smaller clone, the prevalence of aplastic anemia and myelodysplastic syndromes increases, until very, very small clones where there is a miscellaneous of conditions. And we were, of course, able to confirm that thrombotic complications were more frequent in patients with larger clones. But the story is not so simple, because now we are aware of these pre-MDS conditions that are ICUS and IDUS, which are idiopathic cytopenia or idiopathic myelodysplasia of unknown significance, associated or not with some mutations, which, as a matter of fact, are very frequent over the age of 70 and whose exact meaning is not yet known. Yes, in all these conditions, we have PNH clones. For example, we have PNH clones in the so-called hypomegakaryocytic thrombocytopenia, which is an unknown cytopenia of the the megakaryocytic series. We have small PNH clones in chronic idiopathic neutropenia, and we have small clones also in autoimmune hemolytic anemia. So my conclusion and my immunological speculation is that the PNH clone is the scar of an immune attack against bone marrow precursors. And the message, very practic, is that test PNH clone, because this is a very simple lab test. Therapy of PNH, supportive care with folic acid, transfusion if needed, iron replacement. PNH is the only hemolytic anemia with iron deficiency due to hemoglobinuria and hemosiderinuria. In case not availability of eculizumab or before eculizumab, prophylaxis with warfarin was absolutely mandatory. The only curative option is, of course, allogeneic bone marrow transplant, but it is heavily very important transplant-related mortality and morbidity, and is mainly indicated when PNH is associated with severe aplastic anemia. Of course, rituximab, eculizumab with anti-C5 that we have in the clinic since more than 10 years has really changed the story, the natural history of this disease with improvement of anemia, fatigue, transfusion need, and more importantly, 85% reduction in the thrombotic risk. The indications are here listed. Important to underline that the dose can be increased in case of breakthrough hemolysis, of residual anemia. It's important to vaccinate patients against meningococci, and of course being aware that even in vaccinated patients there is the risk of infection, so it's important to educate the patients. However, there are unmet needs in patients after 10 years of eculizumab. We have now data that only a fraction of patients are very good responders to eculizumab with hemoglobin levels greater than 11. We have some patients, about half, with the lower values of hemoglobin but transfusion independent, and we have a fraction that is transfusion dependent. This, of course, may be due to an underlying bone marrow failure or to genetic variants of complement-related genes, but the most important mechanism is C3-mediated extravascular hemolysis, because when we block the complement cascade at the level of C5, upstream components like C3 accumulate on the red cells and cause an extravascular hemolysis mediated by C3, and sometimes, I would say very frequently, a cause positive positivity, adapt positivity. Until a few years ago, we had no treatment options. Sometimes steroids had been tried, splenectomy, with anecdotally some efficacy. The other problem is the breakthrough hemolysis. There are two types of breakthrough hemolysis. One is the pharmacokinetics that occurs just before the subsequent eculizumab dose, and the other one is the pharmacodynamic that occurs independently of the echo administration and generally occurs during massive complement activations, infections, and surgery. And so, what strategies to overcome these problems? One was the modification of eculizumab for increasing half-life. Is the name of the new anti-C5 is ravulizumab, and this was obtained via substitution of some amino acids, but mainly by modification of the Fc region, again using the technology of the neonatal Fc receptor, because in this case we don't want to increase the elimination of the immunoglobulins, but we want to maintain maintain immunoglobulins. So we block the FcRn that increase IgE clearance. In this results in for longer than eculizumab half-life, providing a more constant inhibition of the complement cascade and a better inhibition of free C5 level. The other strategies are blocking activation upstream, avoiding the deposition of C3 on RBC, and so all the extravascular hemolysis, or blocking the alternative pathway, inhibiting the amplification loop upstream C3, and leaving the other pathway active. These are the studies unraveled, both in adult patients naive to complement inhibitors and those that switched from eculizumab to ravulizumab. And basically, both studies demonstrated that ravulizumab is not inferior to eculizumab in terms of transfusion avoidance, LDH normalization, change in LDHs, the change in patient-reported outcomes, and all the well-known markers of PNH. Importantly, the individual data of all the patients enrolled in this study show that the inhibition of C5 was clearly better with ravulizumab. No C5 was found in the patients on ravulizumab compared with those on eculizumab. And the safety is quite comfortable, as no cases of meningococcal infections were observed, and more frequently reported adverse events were headache and other not, of course, severe. The other C3 inhibitor is pegcetacoplan. These are the recently published data. The study enrolled patients that were on eculizumab and were poor responders to eculizumab. There was a contemporary administration of eculizumab and pegcetacoplan for obvious reason of safety. Say that pegcetacoplan is superior to eculizumab in changing hemoglobin levels with very good responses, of course, in poor responders to eculizumab. And the efficacy was reducing transfusions, breakthrough hemolysis, improving FACIT scores, and again, no cases of meningitis were observed. Another monoclonal antibody that again uses the neonatal Fc receptor strategy is crovalimab, which is directed against C5, but has another binding region compared to eculizumab. This is the paper published that shows very well the inhibition of complement activity, then the decrease of LDH, the increase of hemoglobin, both in naive patients, naive to C5 inhibition, and in patients switching from eculizumab to crovalimab. The administration is a sub-Q every 4 weeks, so it's nice for patients. The only problem is that some patients experience a drug-target drug complexes because eculizumab is still present when crovalimab is administered, but these manifestations are transient and mild, is something like a vasculitic skin reaction. and further studies are now ongoing. Then we have danicopan going to the alternative inhibitory factors. This again is the open label phase two study, but it would be quite a phase one. 10 patients untreated who received the monotherapy, and we have a nice reduction of LDH, increase of hemoglobin, increase of facet fatigue, reduction of transfusion need. So again, a very nice response, which is also confirmed in with iptacopan, with is another anti-alternative complement anti-factor B. This again reduces LDH, increases hemoglobin, and some of the patients who were enrolled in the trial were able to stop concomitant treatment with eculizumab, because this study was an add-on study like the pegcetacoplan study. And on the basis of this data, the drug is currently tested as a monotherapy. So the summary of PNH: drugs targeting the complement cascade. More than 10 years ago, we have eculizumab every 2 weeks. And since 2-3 years, several clinical trials. Ravu every 8 weeks is clearly wonderful for patients. Ravuli sub-Q, crovalimab sub-Q every 4 weeks. We have pegcetacoplan twice weekly targeting C5, and danicopan, iptacopan oral treatment targeting the alternative pathway. And probably more are coming. Few slides on typical hemorrhagic syndrome, which is a rare and progressive life-threatening disease characterized by platelet consumption, thrombotic angiopathy, non-immune-mediated hemolysis, and kidney and brain damage. It belongs to really an heterogeneous condition of the so-called thrombotic microangiopathies. The well-known is the chigatoxin-producing hues, but several other conditions induce an hemolytic uremic syndrome: hypertension, pregnancy, kidney transplantation, infection, drug, cancer, and several others. We have the congenital forms, primary or congenital, where the complement overactivation, which is an overactivation of the alternative pathway, is due to mutations in genes encoding for complement regulatory proteins, factor H, A, B, C3, and cofactor protein CD46. And of course, in this condition, the disease is a long life disease with several relapses and really a lot of complications. Eculizumab has been tried in atypical use a lot of years ago. This is 2013. New England paper involved two cohorts: patients with low platelets and renal damage, and patients with renal damage alone. And in both cohorts, the treatment was able to increase platelets and to interrupt dialysis in patients who were on a dialytic program. And for those with a renal involvement, it clearly improved the renal damage with a complete inhibition of complement activation. In the subsequent years, several other studies came out. We found the papers that confirm the earlier benefits in a 2-year follow-up, and we have also several studies that used eculizumab in secondary atypical use, postpartum, Crohn's disease, lupus nephritis, stem cell transplant, and many others that are coming. The problem is to stop or not to stop, because discontinuation has the aim to reduce the risk of infection, reduce the costs, improving quality of life in terms of burden of the patient to go to the hospital. But several case reports, unpublished case, prospective trials that have overall examined all the what happens when the patient stops, the general rule is that it relapses with 20 to 30% of cases relapsing. And so the recommendation is that in this case, the relapse is high after discontinuation with an unpredictable timing. And so the available data suggests an indefinite therapy as the most reasonable recommendation. In case that the patient wants to stop, try to stop, it's important to monitor, although there are no standard rules, but the suggested are to monitor hemoglobin, platelets, creatinine, LDH, at 2 and 4 weeks, then monthly for 6 months, and then every 3-4 months. And more recently, another recommendation is to test also rare germline variants, because in case of negative finding, the risk of relapse are very low, so it's quite good to try to discontinue, but in case of presence, the interruption should be estimated very cautiously. Ravulizumab have also been used in atypical hemolytic uremic syndrome, and all the studies, both in naive, in the switch, have confirmed that Ravu is effective in both in adults and in the pediatric setting with very nice results. Complement involvement in hemolytic anemias, the first slide, and several therapies that we have for targeting the classic and the C3, the C5, and the alternative pathway of complement in this very heterogeneous condition. And thank you for your attention. And this is all the people working in my department, very young, very enthusiastic, and very helpful. Thank you.